When I hear decided to call this lecture something about critical phenomenology, I mean, for me, then it's a rereading of phenomenology, especially existential phenomenology, but also combined with practice theory, and that's not the planning practice, that the everyday practices also involve the practice theory, some feminism, some post-colonialism, to try to develop a way of thinking about bodies. I would structure the talk in those four sections there, where I start about thinking the body, because I do think the body a little bit different from some of the speakers in the morning. And then try to develop it a little more with orientation and disorientation, and then go into the thing that I've been very interested in recently, that Sabine also mentioned, that actually, I must admit, I was a little provoked. I was to an AAG, American Association of Geographers conference. And there, one of my British colleagues was in a panel, Nigel Shrift, and said, "I think we need a new naturalism." And I said, "I don't need any new naturalism." So, and that actually was provoked to give me a paper I wrote recently, the title "In Quest of New Humanism," and also to see, I mean, how actually what happened to the human in all this anti-humanist and post-humanist times. And then, last, I'll try to be a little more concrete in relation to what kind of spatial operations is actually the consequence of this. So that's about what I'll try to do in this half hour, but I'll do my best. Thinking the body. I start on that very much from Merleau-Ponty's genetic phenomenology, where he's actually are situating practical embodied consciousness in the world. That is an interworld where matter and meaning are inseparable. And that's actually one of his main aims in that sense. And there I think it's important to underline that the body here is not just an object or a materiality. It's neither a mere assembly or of its parts. It's a phenomenal lived body. This thing about the lived body is important here, and the lived body is dynamic, it is changing through interaction with an environment. That environment is actually structures it, but it's also responding to it. And that's what I try to characterize with these four characteristics of the body. The first one is saying the phenomenal body is spatial and temporal. And actually, we have talked a lot about that already, but it's important here. And it's situated in space and time, and it also spatializes and temporalizes. That's what I tried to illustrate with those two quotations from. You have them now? What's coming there? Yeah. Those two quotations from Merleau-Ponty and from Lefebvre. I think both of them say something about actually, how is it actually that close connection between the body and the environment is. And I'm not developed much on the quotations there, just leaving there and say what does that mean in relation to the body. I think it first of all mean that we have to emphasize that we still have that place character of the body. Place character of the body. Now, place character of space, sorry. The body is always in place. Notwithstanding a lot of theories about placelessness, about disembeddedness, about mobility and technological development, the body is still in place. And so that also, I mean, the way then you are in place, it's also, I mean, there I may be close to Elke, what she was talking this morning, because that bodily existence is always about involvement. It's about, it's not about just about being in space. It's always a practice oriented towards things and towards other people. We never exist if not in an environment, and we are always connected to other people. And it's all kind of practices that are important here. It's everyday practices as well as more transgressive ones, such as play, struggle, sexuality, love. All of them produce time and space. Here, yeah, a little favorite was coming up in the... Put it over there. Yeah. That's the first thing. The second thing I will mention here, it is that the phenomenal body is inherently reflexive. But it is a reflexivity actually relating to a perception and the knowing body. It's not just a mindful reflexivity, it's a more practical reflexivity as well. And a key word in, I find very interesting in Merleau-Ponty's work here is the concept of reversibility. We are perceiving perceptibles, we are visible seers, we are tangible touchers, we are audible listeners. The mean that it's always a reversible activity that the being as a burden. But we are also self-percipient. That's probably one of the more human things, that actually we can see ourselves as seers. We can reflect about it. But we are also intercorporeal. We can share sensuous experiences in different ways. What's crucible here also, I think, is that reversibility is never perfect. There's always some breaks that means that things like subjectivity and agency slips in here. Not as a rational subjectivity, but as could be called an agentic capacity emerging from that whole intercorporeal field we are part of. The phenomenal process is also simultaneously passive and active. I mean, you can see where I find that the most important, but where it has been most important for me, is actually in relation to a discussion that at least is going on in geography, I also think of many other places, about emotion contra affect. And I feel that discussion a little unproductive. But I actually think that coming from the phenomenal body, we actually can see actually that emotions actually have two interrelated spatialities. On the one hand, what we could call affective space. It's an affective space is where we are in touch, where we are open to the world, where we are affected by different elements in the world, for instance, of public diffusions of joy or fear. A lot of people have been writing about fear in that relation, fear of terror, for instance. But also, I mean, affected by material aesthetic phenomena of architecture and landscape. So this thing about being affected, that side of emotions is the other side. The other side is the performative space. That actually we are as expressive and communicating bodies is actually communicating emotions. We can by gestures, by face, actually communicate emotions that we can read in each other's faces actually. So it's in that sense actually is very expressive, it's performative, it's communicative. The final characteristic I feel is important is that the phenomenal body is ridden with power. It is one part of that is incorporation. It's incorporation that the lived body is actually always layered, always carried social and historical meaning. Malopati talk about sedimented history, and that's actually if some of you have been dealing with Pierre Bourdieu, then when he's talking of habitus, he's actually exactly taking up this thing about the sedimented history in the body. And the other side is, of course, that also Elke talked about the vulnerability of the body to physical as well as symbolic violence. Bodies become objectified, imprisoned, excluded, exploited. They become subjected to gazes, to surveillance, to violence in different forms. I think, one of the most impressive example of that is actually coming from the work of Fanon, when he has been working about actually how the white man's gaze actually are incorporated in the life of the black man. That objectification means that you actually see yourself as a third person as well. He has that, maybe most of you know it, but he has that little story he always repeats during one of his books, saying he was walking on the street. On the other side of the street there was a woman going with a little boy, and the little boy said to her, "Mom, Mom, it's a Negro. I'm frightened, frightened, frightened." And suddenly he experienced, I mean, I'm the one who's actually frightening him. And we met that actually in my the former project we had, where we were interviewing Pakistani people in Copenhagen. And one of the guys was going into a train after the London bombing, and suddenly he experienced everybody was gazing at him and moving a little bit away. And he said, "I suddenly realized, hell, I'm the problem here." So this kind of vulnerability is one of the things. Maybe I should be a little bit careful about examples, but it's good to have examples. The next thing I was talk about would be orientation and disorientation. No, I have that one. It is the development of that classic concept of intentionality in phenomenology. That is saying that consciousness always are directed towards something or somebody. But I feel that it's more open, spatial, and compatible with the concept of orientation. And to be honest, I've stolen that from the British cultural studies woman called Sarah Ahmed, who has been writing quite a bit of orientation. Orientation, in this sense, actually shapes how we inhabit space, how we situate ourselves in relation to things and people, how we find our way, how we come to feel at home, how we negotiate the familiar and the unfamiliar, and estrangement in space. How actually we have different possibilities about extending our bodies into space, depending of, hierarchies, dominations, and things like that. That can be in gender, and that can be in ethnicity. It also shapes how we apprehend this world of shared inhabitants. It's about modes of coexistence, but also about we actually emerge as the effect of shared orientation toward others. I mean, the classic work of Said on Orientalism is exactly about how the Occident identifies itself by actually a shared orientation towards the Orient. So it's important in this sense. And also it's shapes who or what we direct our energy and attention to. We can either be following the line, or we can actually make our own deviations from that line. That can both be spatial, but it can also be other kinds of orientations, sexual orientation or political orientation. So the orientation actually how can you say it? Yeah, actually, now I lost it, but I hope you understand what that means there. Another thing is actually an orientation, thinking about orientation also involves moments of disorientation. Disorientation because something happens that turn our world upside down. Melanchthon talks about experiences of disorder, of disturbance, of giddiness in this sense. An example can be in relation to migration. You move away, you arrive, you re-inhabit a new space, and you move in some way from disorientation towards a reorientation. But it's also about when bodies arrive, that seem out of place, where the two sides of that actually, the body that arrives can feel out of place, but also, it's be about that for the people already in place, they can feel their imaginations disturbed in this sense. It's also important in that sense actually, what happens if that extension of the bodies into space I talked about before are blocked? I mean, you experience restrictions, uncertainty, blockages that actually also really affects you emotionally. I mean, a classic example we had from some of our analysis was when a young man went out to party life in Copenhagen at night and was actually denied access to the discotheques. And definitely a blockage of your way of living in that environment in relation to other people. Okay, maybe a little bit of abstract start about how actually that kind of phenomenological thinking of bodies and space can be, useful in our theorizing of space. now and then I will go to this thing about the new humanism. It is because, I mean, I felt some uncomfortable actually with the very strong dominance of anti-humanist and post-humanist thinking that has been in critical theography where I come from. I mean, there's no doubt about that these thinkings have given a lot of theoretical gains. I would never be without them. But I also think in some sense that they are throwing the baby out with the bathwater in some sense. That's why I actually try to think about that new humanism. And I mean, I couldn't help take this little quotation from Merleau-Ponty with me as well. And that's because, and maybe it's not so new at all, a lot of the discussions we actually have been actually going on in different ways earlier. And he's talking there about actually that, when we talk, and it was in 1960, then when we talk about humanism today, it's not that old shameless humanism, as he says. But a big great help for me actually in this discussion has been an American philosopher called Theodor Sciatsky, also practice theorist, because he tried actually to deconstruct and, okay, what is this thing about humanism? And he put on five moments of humanism, five modes of humanism. The first one is epistemological humanism. That's actually saying it's about privileged human mind as the exclusive place of knowledge. The other one is psychological humanism, that considers humans as the masters of both their psyches and the phenomenon of meaning. That we actually totally control, have insight in our own mind. The third one is definition humanism, saying the being of humanity is such that human life differs absolutely from animal life. Then he talks about agential humanism, that considers that human agency are the one of the greatest significance to social life on Earth. And finally, he's talking about value humanism, where he says that it is a humanism that proclaims that humans are responsible for political ethical values. I mean, the first three forms, I think, probably is quite outdated nowadays. But the last two ones is more tricky. I think at least if we have to work in some way as for a just and hospitable world, they must exist in some form. And that is actually exactly where I think a critical phenomenology can help us. And I think it can that because of for three reasons. First, because it includes the experiential dimension of social life. More structural thinking has actually often have difficulties with the problem of experience, because experience is something you gain through a biographical history. And experience actually, this dimension emphasizes modern, situated experiences of everyday life, embodied, intersubjective, and interwoven with power. The second one is the openness towards the other, human or non-human. I mean, that emphasizes actually how different modes of coexistence always as provisional imperfect solutions to that whole thing about collective life, still is actually totally involved with environment and other people. You cannot not be in being that. And certainly, it rethink agency as agentive capacities that actually originate in intercorporeal interworld. We talk about here about emerging subjects coming out of corporeal existence and particular interworlds. So it's always, I mean, subjectivity is always basically intersubjectivity. So in that sense, I think that you can save, if you could say that, save the concept of human agency, and but still actually hold that environmental and intersubjective connections. Okay, what I'll do as the last thing, I will try to see, okay, what are some of the bodily operations in space, the bodily operation, constructing place, producing place, that that we could look at from that. The first one is spatial realization or acting out of space. It is due to their orientation that body subjects spatialize. They weave places together, they actualize some possibilities, leave others unused, privilege some spatial elements, transform and abandon others. It's about the thing I was talking about a little earlier about following a line is part of that. You follow a line or you deviate from that line. And one author I think actually, especially from that point, gives a lot is Michel de Certeau in his work on practices of everyday life, where he's actually saying, okay, but that is actually what we may be. We spatialize all the time we're doing our everyday life practices. It can be different kinds of practices. It can be differentiated in different temporal spatial beats. That is where maybe Angular phase rhythm analysis came in. I know that probably a lot of people here has worked quite a bit with Angular phase, so it's that part as well. But I also think it's important to say this construction is, of course, gendered. Or actually marked by other ascribed differences. The feminist writer Iris Mann Young made some beautiful things about actually feminine spatiality, about how bodily enclosures can be a defense against invasion, how actually some female bodies are actually socialized to act wise when going in the city. Don't go during the park at night or things like that. But it's that's a part of a more general public space where that is gendered, sexualized, and racialized. So it's not only about gender, it's also about sexuality and ethnicity. The second point is the constitutions of relations or connections between different places. And that is, of course, performed in many scales. And that is actually, what a lot of those series of plays nowadays involve when they talk about relational conceptions of place. This thing about connections with between the local and the global in different ways. For example, I mean, it can have a historical geographical mediation, cross-cultural spatial encounters is often carrying, you know, historical and geographical imaginations that actually is saying that the other is is something, somebody that actually really belong to another place, the Orient, or another time, medieval times. So this thing about that we carry a lot of historical geographical imaginations is part of the relationality, I think. But it's of course also a mediation through technology and materiality. I mean, that is the thing that's important issue in the series of connectivity and relationality that probably most of us have been working with. But it's also about mediated relation in the sense that local action actually is transnationally mediated. It can be a transnational ethic of a responsibility that actually informs local actions. Don Massin has talked about these things about more politically about actually that some of the things that the municipality of London was doing in relation to Venezuela when Chavez was there, then they got some specific prices on oil from Venezuela negotiating and things like that. That is much transnational. But it's also connected in some kind of individual actions. We have imagination of that, a geographical imagination of that area that actually is making those distinctions. So relational can be both good and bad things, to say in that way. The next part is appropriation of space. Nearly all of us probably have dealt with that in some way. And it is, of course, again, a reference to Henri Lefebvre here about resistance, struggle over space. One of the reasons also that Lefebvre talk about that is actually also related to this conception of the body. Because he says that bodies in the everyday life, bodies are never totally dominated. There's always been part of our bodily practices and bodily relations that actually does not get totally dominated by capitalism's abstract space. And that's actually some of the things that are part of constructing the opposition, the struggles there. In Denmark, we also always use the classic example of that with Christiania in Copenhagen. For them of you that don't know Christiania, it was an area earlier occupied by the army that was deserted and was taken over by activists in the 1970s who made their own community in there. There's some kind of heterotopia in the Copenhagen area. And actually now, 40 years after, it still exists. So now it's nearly impossible to get rid of it. For even the bourgeois government didn't succeed because it's been an institution, nearly become an institution now, and a tourist attraction, so that's probably also one of the reasons. But Christiania is one example. You can also have more temporary examples, gay pride parades, for instance. But what's also this very interesting, I think, is that a lot of, and it was mentioned already this morning, that the contemporary deeply spatialized staging of dissent is going on as well. Arab Spring someone's Spanish speaking. Indignados. in Spain and Greece, Occupy in London and New York, etc. And it's a counter-economic practices in public space, and what Maria Caicas, I know she has been here as well, has called indignant squares. New political imaginations coming on and new ways of opposition actually going in. But I think also what's important, and this was Maria also talked about in her recent article about that, is that, okay, I mean, it can be a new political imagination that can do a lot, but it can also be seen as just a cacophony of disparate voices that actually never move you in any way. It can be, as they see it in Greece, be efforts to stage inclusive politics or solidarity, but it can also be nationalist or xenophobic discourses going on. So there's nothing given where we end about this thing. Whatever, however, it also has taken on the last point I take in here, and we heard about that this morning, about self-organization, which is going on a lot in South Europe, where dissent in relation to the experience of crisis and austerity means counteracting and self-organization, new modes of coexistence, revival of community. For example, alternative currencies, time banks, consumers, corporations, social groceries, social medical centers, so some of those things that have been experienced in Greece during the crisis. And with that little optimism in the end, I would say thank you for your attention.